Okay.
Thanks. Welcome to the Gender and Migration Unit at Nova Refugee Legal Clinic. We are launching a mini-series of Zoomcasts to celebrate the 16 days of activism against gender, sexual and gender-based violence. Today we are welcoming Laura Marchesini. Laura is a gender-based violence specialist with over 10 years of experience of focusing on accessing, setting up, managing, and providing technical support to programming and developing global resources. Laura has worked in multiple NGOs such as Solidarity in Action, Oxfam, International Rescue Committee, International Medical Corps, American Refugee Committee, Danish Refugee Council, and now Infactive. Laura has also worked in multiple settings and countries such as Myanmar, Greece, Syria, Iraq, South Sudan, occupied Palestinian territories, Peru, among others. Laura, it's a great pleasure to have you here today among us. Thank you so much for your time. Thank you. So, Laura, would you like to talk about the humanitarian crisis and all the risks that women face in those settings, please? Thank you.
Yes. Due to the shortage of time, I picked a subject that we can easily go through in this shorter amount of time. So, trying to be in line with the theme of the campaign. So we are going to discuss a little bit the general overview on how women and adolescent girls often try to survive in humanitarian settings. So it is important to consider that during humanitarian emergencies, usually gender-based violence is on race. And it is always in terms of rates, in terms of types, in terms of exposure. So the population is usually more vulnerable. The population is usually more at risk of different type of violence, including gender-based violence. And humanitarian emergency goes together with a great amount of needs of the population. That indeed, it is one of the causes that make women and gender-based violence more prevalent during emergencies. That goes together with the lack of services, specialized services for survivors, but also any other type of services and opportunity, including education and job opportunities that are usually only really limited or absent during humanitarian emergency displacement or while you are in a refugee camp or in IDP settlement. When a displace happen or a humanitarian emergency happen, usually there is a shift or there is a shake in the way the gender traditional role are usually established, and that expose women and girls to a higher risk of gender-based violence. So if usually women and girls, is a general example, are not in charge of feed their family in terms of economic responsibilities, sometimes that shift during humanitarian emergencies, because men and boys who are usually the breadwinners of the family are not longer able to provide for the family. So women and girls often have to find their way to survive and to feed the family as well, to collaborate to the economy of the family. The shift in traditional gender role may be risky for women and girls because imagine that many men and boys are engaged in armed group, are engaged in armed group or in army, and they can be injured, they can pass away due to the war. So women and girls often are head of household suddenly, and they have to provide for their family. That means that the gender role not only changed, but also there is a responsibility, totally new responsibility, that sometimes society is not ready to accept, that women and girls have now to work or have to walk long distance to go to work, or that they have like the power to decide about the economic of a family. So this shift, sometimes it feels weird to say that it's not good, because of course we are feminists and we want women to be economically empowered, right? But the shift during humanitarian crisis can be really risky for women and girls, and we have to take that into consideration. This also is related to the fact that in many, not all, but many traditional societies are built up to make women isolated from each other. And that usually it is kind of perpetrated and strengthened during humanitarian emergencies. For one side, women and girls are overburdened by the domestic responsibilities, the fire, the water, the education of the children, the food and everything that they have to take care of. And they are not allowed to be visible in public spaces. So they many times they are isolated from each other, and that also exposes them to a further risk of gender-based violence, because there is no network, there is no connection, there is not a safety network they can refer to. When they are in a situation of having a responsibility, economic responsibility for their families, they may have the opportunity to apply for formal job that may or may not be exploitative, but often is the one that we consider the safest, or informal type of job. However, even if there are like emergencies that allow, for example, women and girls to work with NGOs, because there are a lot of NGOs working in the field, so there is like opportunity for the population to apply for NGOs, no? But there are like some kind of barrier that may still prevent those women to access. Some of them are the same for other population. For example, they have access to work permits or legal documentation, for example. But there are also other type of limitation and barriers that are specific for women and girls. Lack of transportation can be extremely dangerous for women and girls that may, unfortunately, in many humanitarian settings, that may drive to sexual violence, or they may drive to exposure to a different type of violence. And the fact that very often women and girls are not prioritized within the family to be those who have access to educational opportunities. So then, if you are an NGO and you are looking for a WASH officer or for an education officer, probably you need someone who is able to write a report, who is able to facilitate a group activity, or to teach something, or to, you know, to create an activity and to send an email. So women and girls who did not have the opportunity to access to education and did not have the opportunity to work before, so now they are kind of prevented to be hired. So access to formal job opportunities for women and girls sometimes is very difficult. And NGOs sometimes do not realize that the recruitment criteria kind of strengthen the social differences. Because if there is an ethnicity that is richer than the other one, and women of that ethnicity had the opportunity to work and to go to school, so probably we will hire them. But we are like strengthening again the differences between ethnicity that are more vulnerable than others. So what is happening with those who do not have access to those opportunities? So probably they have more chances to record to negative coping mechanism to survive. Negative coping mechanism can be really different from each other. Anyone has a different mechanism that they may or may not apply. Context may like fuel a specific mechanism rather than other one. However, those that I'm giving here are just examples. For any context, we may think about different one. Kind of common, unfortunately, is definitely early enforced marriage. I'm also describing here a little bit of the consequences of each of them. Early enforced marriage is unfortunately very popular in some contexts because it solves different problems. You have one person less to feed at home. You are receiving a joy, so you are receiving money or in-kind donation from the family of the of the family that is going to marry your daughter, for example, and you are kind of keeping the honor of the child. Because of course, adolescent girls in many traditional society cannot be seen if they are not married by other men. So they cannot leave the house, and this is very expensive because they cannot work and they cannot, but they do eat and they do need to be taken care of. So in this way, they can be in another house, you receive some money, and they can be seen by the population. They can go to work, for example. No, the consequences of early marriage can be drastic in the sense that it may create an economic dependence. It may prevent girls to access education, any type of education level opportunities. It can prevent women and girls to decide what is their future, what is their professional path, for example, but it can also bring to unwanted pregnancy. It can also bring to consequences of sexual violence for children that are still very young. So they have like consequences of the development of the person and so on. Other types of negative coping mechanism include the survivor sex. So it is a transition between money and sex, usually, and that goes together with all the consequences of sexual violence, together with the consequences of social stigma. Prostitutes and sex workers are usually isolated, are usually stigmatized, are marginalized. It's very difficult for them to be reintegrated in the society. And be accepted somehow. Moreover, they are extremely exposed to sexual transmittable infection, to unwanted pregnancy, and so on and so forth. Sexual exploitation and transitional sex are basically one more related to the relationship with humanitarian worker when we talk about sexual exploitation. So it is basically sex for food, or sex for NFIs, or sex for medical services, right? That is very dangerous because it's not only dangerous for the consequences of sexual violence, but it's also dangerous because may expose women and girls to not having access to that specific service anymore. So imagine that the only doctor you have in your neighborhood is asking you for sexual favor, so probably you will not longer go to the doctor if you need it, right? And if are in a refugee camp, there is only one doctor, so then probably you will not get the service anymore. And this is very dangerous when there are women and girls that are exposed to gender-based violence or are pregnant or do need medical services or any other type of services. So that has an additional layer of risk. Slavery, it may be any type of slavery. Sometimes slavery includes sexual slavery, sometimes does not. It may include torture, it may have different kind of impact. Unfortunately, it is more common than what we think. And women and girls are often like trapped in those type of mechanism. So this is more or less the presentation I wanted to share. So I leave a little bit of space to have time for the questions.
Okay, thank you so much, Laura. It's a great pleasure to hear you and learn from your experience from the field. So could you please elaborate a little bit more on the negative coping mechanisms and the consequences, and also how can the humanitarian sector identify people who are in a great risk of experiencing one of those or choosing one of those coping mechanisms? Could you please tell us a little bit more about it, please?
Yeah, so the consequences of gender-based violence in general, the consequences of negative coping mechanisms for women and girls, they're usually categorized under four main categories. They are physical, emotional, sexual, or more social, right? Including economical. However, it is difficult to generalize, right? To say, those are the consequences of sexual violence. Yes, of course, there are risks that are very clear to everyone. So if you are a survivor of sexual violence, you are exposed to STIs, you are exposed to unwanted pregnancy or physical infection, and you do need to see a doctor. However, the other types of consequences may change from the person and from the context, because in some cases, the social consequences of being survivor of sexual violence are very, very important in specific society. And that may have an economical, social, and psychological impact that is bigger than for women that are living in other society. But also the capacity and the resilience at the personal level is very different from one woman to another one. So it is difficult to generalize and say those are the consequences of that. However, as we were mentioning before, so each of the negative coping mechanisms has specific consequences that we had go through a little bit. In terms of what we can do as a humanitarian worker, we have to think about the three main area of actions. So we can think about the response. So when that happened, what we can do, what we can do to prevent that to happen, and what can we do if we see that there is the risk of that happening, to mitigate the risk, to not reinforce like a specific dynamic that may create risk of negative coping mechanisms or gender-based violence. So those are the three main areas. When we talk about response, we are talking about having trained and prepared staff able to deliver compassionate and survivor-centered services that do not judge, that are based on active listening, that put the survivor in a position to decide what is the path and the recovery path they want to take. So give back the power to the survivor while they are taking the services they need, whether they are medical, whether they are psychological, whether they are legal, whether they are police or safe shelters, or any type of services they, or livelihood or income generating opportunities, any type of services survivor needs, they need to receive it, but delivered by trained staff who is able to deliver survivor centered services. Otherwise, we are going to exacerbate kind of the risk of stigmatization and to make person feel they are the one who did something wrong. No. So the response is usually very similar from location to location and from context to context, because I'm Italian. In Italy, in Portugal, in New York, or in South Sudan, women need medical response, women need psychological response, women need to create a social network, women need to have access to income. So the needs of a survivor are very similar to each other, and the response has to be standardized at the level of quality, no? What changed the most are the risk mitigation strategy that we can think about and the prevention. So in population in which the gender roles are traditional and are somehow dangerous for women and girls, or disempowering for women and girls. So probably we have to work a lot with communities and think about the prevention at the level of primary and secondary prevention. When we talk about primary prevention, we are talking about what do we do to prevent the violence to happen. And when we talk about secondary prevention, we are talking what can we do to prevent the escalation of violence to keep escalating. Okay, so in the case number one, in the case of primary prevention, when we talk about gender-based violence and negative coping mechanism, we have to inform community about the risk of negative coping mechanisms. We have to inform community about how much a supportive community for women and girls, having the opportunity for women and girls to access formal job and to not incur in like shortcuts, like early marriage, what is the benefit of it, right? And what is the risk of early marriage, for example. So something that may prevent the violence to happen. When we realize that, for example, we are in an environment where domestic violence is very, the rate of domestic violence is very high, for example, we decide usually to go for a secondary prevention. So directly working, for example, with households, both the men and women, for example, or with men only, and engage them in discussion groups and talk about what is the relationship they have at home with their wife, for example, with their daughter. Not so identifying that there is a problem in the community, so what are we going to do to de-escalate the problem? No? And then there is the piece of GBV risk mitigation. So for example, if we realize that there is an area where women cannot really access because it's full of men or it's full of armed group or it's dark or I don't know. So we are not going to put a distribution point there, right? Or we are not to open a women and girls safe space there because that is going to be dangerous. They are not going to come. And if they come, they're going to be exposed to a risk that we don't want them to be exposed to. So the mitigation of the risk is usually the responsibility of humanitarian workers to collaborate together, to see what are the best practices they want to put in place. And this is usually what we have to do and what we do to prevent that to happen. In terms of what we can do better, if I remember correctly, that was one of your questions. So I am really an advocate, especially for GBV programming, at least, or for gender programming, to think about how much do you need to have a psychologist to work in a women and girls space? Because maybe you don't need a psychologist. You need a person who is like willing to take on the responsibility that you're gonna give them, or what is the attitude and the belief those person have toward gender-based violence. Sometimes it's more important to have a person who has an attitude and a behavior that is women friendly, rather than have a specialist that is hired for his technical background, but then is not really women friendly. So considering that the competencies of women and girls in humanitarian setting often are not in line with the requirement of the vacancies, so we need to think about what are we creating and to try to really make those jobs accessible to women and girls. If legal, right? In many countries, unfortunately, refugees cannot work legally, but when possible, so the opportunities for women and girls have to be made available, especially if we are talking about program for women and girls. We cannot really hire men just because women and girls do not have educational background, because otherwise we are also perpetrating a violence against women and girls. So we need to find our way out, or at least promote capacity building long-term strategy to create the capacity for women and girls to apply for position, because otherwise it's too easy for them to recur to negative coping mechanism. And we somehow have to stop the cycle by giving like practical tools, no, to that they can directly use.
Thanks so much, Laura. You brought two amazing aspects. On the one hand, it's also important to bring men together and to have special programs for men to also to, I guess, help to deconstruct some traditional ideas and customs that they may have and that may increase the risk of women to survive to SGBV on the one hand. And also I have observed that in the field work, that it's also necessary to have programs for men. So working with women on the one hand and men as well on the other hand, though in different programs, obviously. So that's super interesting if you'd like to develop a little bit more on that. And another aspect that it is so interesting, and I have to confess I had never thought about it, which is, one thing is having the formal education and formal professional skills. Other thing is being SGBV friendly, having a friendly attitude towards the SGBV survivor and having the perfect mindset to help to deconstruct all the stereotypes that will increase SGBV risks on the one hand, and also with the right mindset to provide the help and support to SGBV survivors, which sometimes people may not have, although they may have the formal education, as you have just said it. And that's actually brilliant. It's a really key aspect to bear in mind. Thank you so much for bringing that up. Would you like to develop a little bit more? We have a few more minutes if you'd like.
I will focus on the man and boys piece, I guess. Okay, so basically, if we want to engage with women and girls in general, so let me do a really general and traditional example. So look, we are working in women and girls safe spaces, for example. And this is a program for women and girls. We would like women and girls to access women and girls' safe spaces, but they do not take a decision at home, so they are not the one who decide whether or not they can come to the women and girls' safe space. So if we want them to access, even if it's just for this reason, we need to engage with men and boys, because we need to build the trust of men and boys that allow women and girls to access our program. Otherwise, they will not come. And if they do come, that we're really suspicious. This happens a lot if the program is not well thought since the beginning, that men and boys, community leaders, religious leaders start like thinking, what are they doing? They are like arming up our women to fight against us, or they are revolutionary people there. We don't want our girls to go there and stuff. No, so it is like a creation of rumors that definitely prevent women to go, but is also kind of meaning the end of the program. So engaging with men and boys will definitely help the access to women and girls to any type of programming. At the same time, it is internationally recognized that gender-based violence disproportionately affects women and girls. And in cases in which men and boys are submitted to gender-based violence, the big majority of the time, gender-based violence is perpetrated by male in both cases. So we do recognize that main perpetrator of gender-based violence are men, in some case boys, but exponentially men. So if we want to prevent gender-based violence, we need to engage with men. So for one side, working on the empowerment of women and girls, it is a task that has to be carried out with women and girls, and is the responsibility of women and girls to empower themselves and find their path to empowerment and to work on it. At the same time, we cannot pretend they are not suffering violence at all when they go back from our programming, or they are not framed in a traditional society that do not allow them to give opinion or to speak publicly or to spend time in front of other human beings or to interrupt a conversation, or they are not free. So despite the fact that the empowerment of women, it is in the hands of women, men have a huge impact on the safety of women and girls. So to increase the safety of women and girls, we need to engage with men. So there are different ways to engaging with men, depending on the objective. If the objective in some instance is, for example, to make sure that the income of the house, the household is like spent for priorities that include education of the children, medical situation, food, reparation of a solar system or the house, reconstruction or whatever. But men do not have this capacity of managing these resources. So there are like different type of programming that can put together men and women, that women usually have more like the focus on spending money for the family, and together work together to find like an healthy way to manage the income and to the economy of the house. There are other type of programming that are looking straight to gender-based violence, and they are like, for example, discussion groups, thematic discussion group with men and boys, or with men only, or with community leaders and men, or religious leader and community leaders and men, depending on the setting. And they are going to address specific harmful traditional practices, for example, early marriage, okay, or access to education for women and girls, or I don't know, any other type of tradition that they may have that is risky and negative for women and girls, so that can be discussed. It is a very, very, very difficult activity. It's one of the most difficult activity of gender-based violence programming, because it can turn around like a boomerang. If it's not properly planned and delivered by trained staff, you may not able to navigate the discussion to end toward your objective. You may find yourself stuck in traditional beliefs and not being able to get out of them. And this is very dangerous. This is really what we do not want to happen. No? So more in general, engaging with communities is always needed, also to promote the type of services we provide, also to promote the fact that we are there, that there is a kind of a protocol in place for confidentiality, for safety, what is the need of receiving those type of services, medical services, can be life-saving for a survivor of rape. So those type of information, and where to get the services, and how much time do you have to get the services. So has to be an information that everyone understands and everyone has. So promotion of services, but also promotion of healthy communities and so on, has to be always part of the program.
Just to one last question, Laura, regarding humanitarian response, what do you think should be strengthened to increase the protection to women and girls, for instance? For sure, there are a lot of room for improvement. There's always room to improve. Would you like to stress anything?
Yeah, basically, I think that something is changing now. We are going, we are improving probably a little bit in terms of internal management of humanitarian response. I'm thinking about the prioritization of gender-based violence sector. So until now, it has been and still is a fight to find like a support, a general support to prioritize gender-based violence programming. Okay, it is usually understood as not a priority, not a life-threatening. Gender-based violence programming do not work through figures, and it is basically one of the basically the only sector that do not work through figures, because so imagine that you are living in your building, no, and in your building in your block there are like 20 apartments. How many women do suffer gender-based violence in your building? No idea, no? If one of them report, so you may say that it is one woman, but maybe they are 18 and you have no idea. So this is the proportion. So you have no idea how many women are suffering gender-based violence. You just know that this is everywhere. And in a situation of emergency, this exponentially increase. And if services are, quality services are available and are accessible, safely accessible, so more women will report. So often we have higher number of women where the number of gender-based violence is less. If there are no services and the services are bad quality, nobody will report. So probably there is way more gender-based violence because there is not a culture of responding to it, but nobody will report it. So figures in gender-based violence does not mean anything. We can think about estimation of, or percentages. We can say among the total amount of gender-based violence survivor, the 50%, it seems to be survivor of sexual violence. But this is based on the data that we have that are still not really representative somehow. So working without data has to be like understood by the humanitarian sector, that this is not the way gender-based violence sector work. And that has been really a struggle during the last years of implementation. GBV, it seems to be something like very not a priority. So shifting this view and prioritizing gender-based violence programming, but also understand that GBV prevention and risk mitigation responsibility is the responsibility of every humanitarian worker and every humanitarian sector. Because while GBV response services like medical, legal, case management, psychosocial, you need to have like training and structure and so on, to mitigate the risk of GBV is your responsibility. You are not going to deliver humanitarian assistance at 2 a.m. in the morning and put the women and girls at risk to go and take it. So there is, or you are not going to create a latrine where everything is dark or there is no lock or et cetera, et cetera. No? So the responsibility of protecting women and girls is a responsibility of the whole humanitarian community. The responsibility of the GBV programming and to do like primary and secondary prevention and to respond to GBV. But we do need a shift in the view of gender-based violence.
Well, thank you so much, Laura. It was a great pleasure to hear from you and to learn from you as well. Thanks for your time and for your generosity to share your experience with us. Thank you so much.
Thank you for having me. It was a pleasure. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Take care. Bye-bye.
Okay, bye-bye. Okay.